I know people tend to think shonen means happiness, friendliness, and protagonists can do no wrong, all good-hearted. With that said, how the hell this is shonen? The truth hurts. The truth will not set you free. It goes without saying, this series is full of surprises. At the same time, the actuality made a lot of sense. The next anime season can't come any sooner. The reaction will be jarring. I believe so, because I was floored by the revelations. This chapter had me in one crazy emotional roller coaster. The cliffhanger was the cherry on the top, and that's one Sunday I don't want to have. Going into the chapter, I was expecting Eren to try to convert Zeke's opinion with the rest of the memory trip. Technically, I was right, but not the exact outcome I was expecting. Zeke summarized the last chapter well by stating Eren wasn't manipulated by Grisha. His life was all lively and well until the wall was torn down, of course. The point is, Grisha has nothing to do with Eren's influence. So why Eren backstab Zeke? Why not end the war? What is his agenda? Life truly began with Eren saving Mikasa. Remember the image of Eren and Armin happily hanging out. The tone is going to get heavy. The scene with Eren's first visit with Mikasa now carries more weight than simply Mikasa's turning point, let alone a defining development. It speaks for Eren's character to be a boy who will grow up to be a man who will fight for his freedom. If there are men that intend to steal his freedom, he will steal theirs. The shot of the worrisome father trying to calm his furious son let out a troublesome feeling. The way I see it is, Grisha didn't want to see his son to go to the path he made a mistake to take. When you recall the last chapter, life was going to be normal with not following Kruger's order. However, this moment was the beginning of a path that will ultimately set the story straight. Eren's pride denies Grisha's desire to restore Eldia. In a twisted way, Eren should be thankful for Grisha's action to open his eyes, which means the father is the savior of the world. Wrap your head around that. I do wonder what is up with Eren's expression when he watches his young self wrapping the scarf around Mikasa. It's a look of guilt, if anything. I don't want to interpret it as a parent moment because that would cause a war. But seriously, I do believe Eren owes her an apology after that act of heartbreak. It was seriously messed up. Hate is a strong word. Hopefully, they patch up their relationship. And, well, we'll see where we go from there. I recall fans were confused on why Zeke, who has the Founding Titans' power in control, will go to this memory trip to help Eren. I called it. He did it to save him, not going to abandon him. I like the fact he referenced Tom, clear indication of what he considered family. Eren is the only one Zeke has left, and despite not being the little brother he wished for, blood is thicker than water. I also like more of a collage of Grisha's moments, including the famous basement, leaving a note for the story's great advancement. Then this is where the chapter unfolds the craziest revelation to date. Shifting back to chapter 1 left me feeling a good kind of nostalgia. However, that's not the intention. It builds up the moment when Grisha leaves the house with his family alive and well for the last time. The tone I'm feeling is morbid because we know the downfall begins on that very day. The panel paid close attention to Grisha's expressions as Eren argues with his mother about joining the Survey Corps. It's all going accordingly, but then shocking part number one comes in. The scene when Grisha promised Eren to return with secrets waiting to reveal is seen much differently. In fact, I was legit horrified. The truth is, Grisha was in fact staring at adult Eren when he made that promise. What? I couldn't shout what any louder. The scariest part is the scene wasn't altered. It's like that in the very first chapter. It's not like Isayama went out of his way and retconned the position. It was designed that way from the very start. It's most likely just me, but it's downright eerie to see Grisha watches his family one last time with only Eren being happy and joy. After all, the path will be favoring him from this point on, and Grisha can't escape the inevitable. Massive foreshadow for the major revelation. The confrontation with Grisha and Frida is an emotional roller coaster that I won't forget for a long time. This is the moment where the series took the course of the story we know today. As we all know, prior to this extended scene, Grisha invaded Frida and the King of the Walls' headquarters and killed them to devour the founding titan. My first impression was Grisha was a murderer that would do whatever it takes to fulfill his destiny. After the last chapter, I assume he had no choice but to kill them because of the invasion, awaken his old mission to fulfill and carry forward. But now, I am lost with words right from the start. Grisha announced his heritage and pleaded them to save his family and citizens of the walls from the Titans. This completely destroyed the thought of him killing them from the get-go. The fact he begged them first gives me a better impression of his character. He was no longer the old self who was hell-bent to save Eldians. He wanted to avoid hell at all costs. I feel bad for him before. My sympathy is growing more. It doesn't stop there. Frida turned down his pleading because of her belief. She believed this is their sins, and Judgment Day has come. They can't afford to use the Founding Titan and fall to the wrong hand. They must accept the price they made. In short, Frida told him to deal with fate. I guess it's not a bad argument on falling to the wrong hand, but it does irritate me to think maybe, just maybe, the conflict could have been prevented. I find it funny how Zeke thinks he and Frida will get along really well. When you think about it, they might as well, considering how their train of thoughts are quite similar. The sensation gets worse. Grisha begged them again, but now is making me sad. His expression screamed pain, agony, and broken apart. Frida, on the other hand, started to frustrate me. Maybe you don't find her wrong, but it's mainly due to how Grisha was suffering from a possible solution. If it wasn't for the last chapter, I wouldn't be this sympathetic. It's not to say she's the villain, but two different beliefs don't collide well. No matter how much he cried for help, she sticks to her words and let them perish as they felt they are rightfully judged. Eren's face is filled with anger. I got chills. Now, this is where the chapter begins to drown me in a pool of revelations. Grisha finally gets to the part where the fans know exactly what happened. Genocide. Not without a shocking reveal, however. We all know that each shifting titan has his own perks. Attack Titan was interpreted as a fighter, hence the title Attack. But was that really it? The real perk is the ability to receive the message from the future successor. In other words, foresee the future. Many have guessed it, but it's great to have clarification now. I'll explain more on that review later. The amazing part about this review is the contrast. Attack Titan revolves with the future as the Founding Titan revolves with the past. It's practically the future versus the past. It gives the name Attack more meaningful when you include the mythology, let alone the fitting nature for Eren. Isayama, you are a sly man. Grisha was ready to shift to Attack Titan and begin to kill them, all for the greater good. Well, at least in story viewpoint, I think. Then, a big surprise happens. The scenery led me to believe this is the moment. It was, but something is different. Grisha refused to kill them. I was downright confused. I thought we have a multiverse in our hands. I thought I needed sleep. Part of me believed he gave up now, only to rebound later to kill them. But it wouldn't be necessary for Isayama to write this. It was depressing to watch him cry and refuse to kill children, which again gave me a much better impression of his character. However, if the timeline is fixed for him to kill them, how can he recover? This is where my mind was blown. Adult Aaron approaches to Grisha, screaming at him to get up and kill. Like Zeke, I was completely lost with words. Aaron shouts at Grisha in tyranny tone, and words that are painful as stabbing. It's not even encouraging. It's purely manipulative. He pressured him on and on and on until he finally made his move. This is the story he started. The scene is far worse than before. And trust me, that's saying a lot. I couldn't comprehend on what just happened, but it's actually what it was shown. Aaron manipulated Grisha. How is this shonen? My brain isn't processing well enough to continue. Our hero is the main villain. Well, not really, but the action is incredibly twisted. When you have to fight, you fight. Aaron has stuck to the code since the beginning, and this is where it led him to. It's not to say he loves to kill, rather, had no choice on the matter to advance to freedom. You can tell by his reaction towards the mass killing. It's whatever it takes gone horribly disturbing. This is madness. As for Grisha, I'm astounded. First, he came off as a villainy character. Then, a redeemed character. Now, I can safely say, he's the most tragic character of them all. That is unholy. Reina, you have been Reinered. It's incredible how Isayama can decipher a character that is more than meets the eyes. I haven't changed my opinion on a character this many times before. But here we are. It's hard to watch him cry, wondering if this pleased Aaron. He also begged to see the rest of the future. Attack Titan was tearing him apart. Although it's more than black and white, Aaron comes off as a villain to his mind. The son manipulating the father? That's messed up. Grisha's life is suffering. To add more weight to his character, he can finally clearly see Zeke in the current time. The following scene is really heartbreaking. I didn't expect Zeke to receive a closure under this circumstance. The way how it was written made it seem like Aaron is hell, but Zeke is the son he wants to communicate. He tells him that Aaron's future is chosen and Zeke won't have his. Once he sees him clearly, he embraces for forgiveness. It hits me in the feel with Grisha hugging his first son and Zeke calls him dad. That's powerful. Family is family. Before closing out, Grisha has one last words. Stop Aaron. It seriously paints Zeke as the protagonist. If you throw this manga to a person who never reads it or watches, they would believe Zeke is the main character. That's how crazy this development has been. In case this is too confusing for anyone, Zeke summarized the whole revelation. I like the detail on Zeke calling Grisha dad, only to revert back to calling his name. The embracement affected him dearly, and understandably so. It's the fatherly love he wished to have, and he got it. Long story short, Aaron foresees the future through his future self's memory, which led him to manipulate Grisha to set the path we're journeying through today. Aaron learned about everything 4 years ago, the moment when he held Historia's hand. How rewarding. Let's discuss about the reveal on time messaging. Some speculated that they can travel through time. The reality is, they can only receive the message from the successors as well as their presence. Based on Grisha's early turmoil, this eliminates actual time traveling And it's probably for the best. The series could get really messy when one can actually jump through time and alter it at will. By then, I mean changing a timeline multiple times, a la multiverse. It narrows down to one timeline to focus on, with the use of possibly multiverse visions. It's kind of hard to explain. Then again, I'm not really good at explaining in this type of scenario. I like to think of the series Orange. In there, the story involves with students that receive messages from future selves in order to correct their mistakes. There's no time jumping, no other multiverse to explore, aside of one for characters' purposes, and it only focuses on one timeline. In short, what we see is one timeline that has been invaded by the future. It doesn't mean they will jump time now. The damage is done. This is the path. As for Eren, the mastermind, it made tons of sense. It's no wonder Grisha appeared in miserable pain prior to passing down the Titans to Eren. Now I get why he told Shadis to not get involved. He was manipulated by that point, and his destiny was to fulfill future Eren's future. It connects far back to Kruger with his confused statement about Mikasa and Armin. Maybe there will be more towards it, but since Eren is the mastermind, it's no wonder those two names were brought up. It's incredible when you look back and see the pieces coming together. As for Eren's character, it's believable to think he has changed when he saw the memories. The only part that is missing is whether he can see everything or only certain pinpoints. It's addressed more or less at the end, but we'll get to that very soon. The reason to be concerning is due to how Eren has been plotting and reacting. It's not said the future is predetermined, but perhaps it's why Eren has been trying to change something. Once he saw the memories, his focus changed drastically, wanted to take down the world for freedom. What I want to know is, does he know every outcome, including Sasha's death? He was frustrated when he heard the news. Was it a reaction to his future fate unchanged? Connie did say he laughed as well. Did he laugh because of an act of a villain? Or was it a reaction towards his destiny to be inevitable? It's clear that Eren is trying to change the journey, but the destination is locked in. This is merely a speculation. There's a chance for Eren to elaborate his memory trip in depth. We know he has, but we don't know what he has seen. One of my predictions has Zeke converting to Eren's side, alas the good side, if you can even call it that. Honestly, it sounds pretty damn silly. Reminds me of Naruto in his worst days, which is why I hope it doesn't happen. Fortunately for me, Zeke resumed his first and only intention and forced Ymir to enter the paths to end the Eldians. You would think Grisha's forgiveness would change his mind. Instead, it encouraged him. Now, against Eren and favor for Grisha. What a crazy roundabout. Zeke does bring an interesting point though. If Eren becomes desperate to stop Ymir, wouldn't this mean he didn't see this coming? Can he only see certain destination? My guess is, he has seen everything. So he is trying to change his journey, but the destination remained the same. That, or it's gotten worse. It's hard to say, but regardless, if Eren fails to stop Ymir, the future doesn't belong to his. This chapter was quite something else. It's remarkable with its execution and paneling. I couldn't do justice on describing the impact of these panels, especially the last scene with Grisha's and Frida. The artwork has come a long way from chapter 1, and is fortunately presented really well here with deep and sorrowful expressions. The revelations were mind-blowing, yet the puzzles fit in place. It ended on a hell of a cliffhanger, probably worse than the time Eren lost his head. This is it. The path to end all. We're in the endgame now. And that will do it for the review. I hope you enjoyed this one. It's worth mentioning, Eren did not show Zeke the moment when he ate Grisha. I don't know why he brought that up. Could there be more to it? I don't know how many revelations I can take. This chapter was crazy. Aside from that, we have this defining moment that could change everything. What do you think of this chapter? Share your thoughts in the comment section. If you like this and want more of this, subscribe to my channel, and my world will be yours to stay. Until next time, take care.